today I wanted to give you a quick tour of the project I'm currently working on that is called Boxel. Boxel is made with Vulkan, which is the successor to OpenGL. Boxel is made in C++ and uses GLSL as its shader language. The first thing that came to my mind is, how are voxels made? Basically, voxels are just pixels but in three dimensions. So the challenge is to understand how can we store them efficiently in memory so that it doesn't take too much space, and also so that we can render them efficiently and a lot of them, so that we can make maybe a cool game with it. So Vulkan is, as I said, the successor to OpenGL. It's way more verbose, and you need a lot more line of codes to just draw a simple triangle, but it gives you so much more control over what you do in your application that I thought that was a good challenge and a good graphics API to use for the challenge. The biggest question was, how do we store voxels? And one of the techniques I found was to use sparse voxel octrees. Now, if you want to learn more about the sparse voxel octrees, I strongly invite you to take a look at the video from Ozone about it. He explains it very well, and it's very straightforward. This will be very important as to how we will render our voxels, because a sparse voxel octree will be way faster than just looping over a 3D grid to just render our voxels if we want to have at least real-time performances. So now that I know how to store my voxels, I needed a way of rendering them, and one of the approaches that I had was to use the ray tracing capabilities of the RTX GPUs. So I first tried that. I created the mesh for each chunk of voxels, then I sent that mesh to the acceleration structure building setup, and then tried to run them, and it was pretty successful. I had my chunks of voxels rendering, and it was pretty nice. After that, I wanted to add some colors to my voxels, so I did it. After some time and some bugs, I got color indexing per voxel working, which was pretty nice. So each voxel had its color rendered properly for each chunk, but then I encountered some other issues that were memory. So memory was used up quite fast because I needed space to store the octree, store the mesh data for each chunk, and then store the acceleration structure needed by the ray tracing algorithm to actually trace the rays and render the voxels. So that was quite adding up, meaning that I had almost like 300 megabytes of memory used by chunk of voxels, which was quite a bit, and this was no good to render a whole terrain full of those voxels. So I implemented a quick LOD system where the voxels that are far away from the player were rendered with less resolution than the ones that are close to the player. It was working pretty nice, but I started to see that the ray tracing, the hardware ray tracing was maybe a no-go for this project. And also generating that terrain was costing a lot of performances to generate the octree, then generate the mesh data and the acceleration structure was taking quite a bit of time, and it was not as fast as I wanted to be. So it was not really good for a big terrain generation that the player would move across. So then I said, fuck ray tracing, and let's go with the custom rendering algorithm, and that's where I am today. I first took a look at how can we render voxels using a compute shader and directly using the octree data that I have generated to render those voxels, and I had 10 FPS. And that was for a cube of maybe 5x5x5, which was not good, but it was a start. I had a first little chunk of voxels showing up with my custom rendering algorithm, and I was pretty happy about it. And the color accessing was straightforward, so it was a pain relieved. So then I wanted to see if I could render a bigger chunk of voxels, and the answer is yes. If you only look at it from a specific angle and you don't care about the interior of the chunk. But after fixing that and some other minor bugs, I had a bigger chunk rendering and it was smooth. And from now on, it's just fun, right? And the first thing I did was generating a sphere in a 64x64x64 octree, which was looking pretty nice, I must say, and it was rendering with almost a steady 60 FPS, so that was pretty good. And then I wanted to see, well, let's render double the size of the octree, so it was 128 cube for the octree, and it was looking pretty nice. The sphere was rendered perfectly without any glitch, and the performances were quite good, so I was really happy about it. And then I wanted to try some other shapes, and I tested the torus, which was running pretty nice. Performances were good, there were no glitches, no stutters, no performance issue whatsoever, so that was pretty good. And then I wanted to add an SVO visualization so that I can see if the SVO is currently traversed and there are no data that is lost or performance that is lost. And this is what I had. An SVO visualization is looking pretty nice. I like the way that it kind of highlights the model that you're rendering. It was pretty satisfying to see. Man, it was also pretty satisfying to see that everything worked as intended. So then I wanted to stress test my computer a bit by generating a grid of 4x4 chunks of voxels, and each chunk is basically 128x128x128 voxels, and this sums up to approximately 33,500,000 voxels on the screen possible, with a memory footprint of 500 megabytes, which is quite good, and 30 FPS, so that was decent enough for me to investigate and find performance optimizations. And then I tried to implement my previous LOD system that I used for the ray tracing capabilities to my new rendering algorithm, and it was working quite nice. I had different chunks of different sizes render currently on the screen, and this allows me to have real-time performances to render a lot of voxels with a small memory footprint, and maybe real-time gameplay possible in a very detailed voxel world. So this is where I am right now. I'm currently trying to generate the terrain around the player with that same LOD system, but based on the distance from the camera instead. So this is it for this time. I'm currently trying to generate the terrain around the player using the same LOD system, but based on the distance from the camera now. So this will make it possible to generate an infinite terrain around the player with decent performances and a decent memory footprint, but this will be in the next devlog. If you like this one, feel free to subscribe to the channel, leave a like, and don't forget to check the Twitter page that I've linked in the description, because this is where I post the development progress before I post YouTube videos about it, so feel free to check it out. I wish you all a very good day, and I see you next time.